I just wanted to remind you that we're here on Monday morning starting another fresh week here with the Hello Hello Show on the September 19th, year 2011. I'm waiting for my guests today to speak about the project of Una Escuelita. Franco Canova and Pope Noel are going to be here, so I'm just getting ready here to receive them for a wonderful interaction. I'm looking forward to interact and talk about the wonderful things that they're doing with their school, things that are close to my heart, as I do work with art and as I do believe that the new generation is can get the best chance of their lives in getting involved with art and all of these wonderful, delicious things. As I said, Monday morning, September 19th, here with the Hello Hello Show, I'm just getting ready, as I said, to get to receive my guests, Franco Canova and Pope Noel. Well,
good morning, as we're sitting here at LTV on this beautiful morning, starting another fresh week here on Dead LTV, here with the Hello Hello Show on Monday morning, September 19th, year 2011. And as I have mentioned earlier, my guests this morning, my guests this morning are Franco Canova, thank you so much for showing up, and Pope Noel, thank you so much for showing up. I mentioned before you came on the show earlier that this issue of working with kids and art is close to my heart, as I've been fortunate enough to work with the project most, and really that they're allowing me to extend my improvisational approach to how I think kids can be happy, how I think kids can be will remember certain things that are trivial for the rest of their lives, and things of this nature. So it's very close to my heart in a sense of mixing art with, i.e., hope for the future, the stabilization of the tender mind of the young generations. You know that people think it's not as real as it really is on the surface. You know, and I can tell you for myself, I wish that when I was young that I could get introduced to certain things via art, which in my life did not exist for, you know, throughout my childhood. But anyway, I'm so happy to have you here. I know that the message is long and meaningful. And first, I want to know how you're doing since the last time we saw you here.
I'm doing pretty good, Chaim. Life is just getting better and better with each and every waking day, you know. I have a great life, because I hardly think about myself. And the more I stay out of my own way, the better off I am.
I need to know more details about that after the show.
That's the key to success, you know. Stay out of your own head and do something for someone else. That's what this project with Una Escuelita has been all about for me, and I think for Pope also. You know, our motto is learning life through art, and we believe that you can teach anyone anything through art. And that was the beginning of the development of Una Escuelita. Pope was down there pretty much with not very many things at his disposal, but his imagination and art. And the kids gravitated towards that. Why don't you talk a little bit about that, Pope?
Pope, how are you doing? It's been 2 years almost.
I'm alive and breathing well. I've experienced a few complications and challenges down there. And I think we're doing pretty well. I try and complain sometimes to myself, but upon review, none of it holds up very long. I have a lot more things to be grateful for than I have to not be happy with. I'm really glad to be back here in East Hampton after 2 years, or in New York, or in the United States, and I have to say that this is the best place on earth. And East Hampton, I think, is, I would put way up on the list, or this area. And the people here, the most interesting, the best.
So you know what, it's interesting, obviously you're an artist and your art is a part of your life. I wanted to know about the extension of that identity, you know, of art in your life as you work with kids. You know, I wanted to, you maybe if you can try and talk a little bit about how it stretches into what you see unfolding in the life of the kids, because you're an artist. You're I don't know if people are aware out there of the fact that you're, you know, an artist. Period.
How does it translate itself on the surface as you kind of introducing that to kids and as you, you know, trying to stretch the message and to make it real for in the lives of the kids?
They love to paint things, sticks, boards, rocks, because we do not have canvas, and we have paper, a lot of paper, but they love to paint the objects. And my own personal art has changed by looking at what they do. Sometimes I seize what they're painting and I take it to my little studio. I actually have a studio now, and I elaborate on the indigenous little marks and the way they start off. And you know, they have in their state supported schools there, especially when you get out of the towns, and even in the towns there's no art class, there's no art supplies. In fact, there's no supplies at all. It's a very, very, very poor country, and the first things that get cut when the leaders of these countries get in financial problems is health and education. And it's been slashed in Nicaragua substantially since I've been there, both of these. We make do with house paint, tempera paint, and the little bottles of acrylic paints that you can buy, that you can still... Actually, the stores that I used to buy the children's art supplies from in Nicaragua, the shelves are almost bare. These countries are like, we're having problems here, they're having many more problems. Where you could go and have a full selection and pick a lot of stuff out, now you get red, blue, yellow, black, no white.
No white.
Sometimes, so you can't mix colors. But you know, we make do. I get quarts of house paint, and we divide it into little things, and we make. I thought that when I lived here in New York, I could dart to the city and go to Pearl Paint, and I would not be happy with the stuff I came back with, you know, $200 worth of stuff. And now, for $15 or $20, we can, it's amazing.
Yes.
You can do it with nothing, almost.
Absolutely, absolutely. And Frank, why don't you, remind us of the technical aspect? Because, if, for example, last time you were here, you were breaking grounds, you were building things, you were stretching.
Before I get into that, what I'd like to say is that we were just talking about the children and the children having a limited amount of art supplies and a little bit of knowledge as to what art is and what it's all about. What I find even more astounding is the adults. The adults have never had anything to play with. They've never had any introduction to art. They've never held paintbrushes. They've never done art. And when it's introduced to the adults, which Pope has done that with people that work for us, the cook, the cook's assistant, the maid, and they come and they sit, they come before their day's work, and they'll actually sit for hours and hours, and with a little bit of a direction with Pope, showing them how to do what they pick it. Do they pick it up rather quickly?
Some of them probably.
Actually painting, you say?
Some of them could. Yeah. One that could have been famous.
Really?
She's very, very talented. She's maybe 45 or 50 years old. She doesn't do anything that's not pleasing to the eye, and it's all these indigenous, she's old enough to know all the indigenous symbols from the pottery and the...
Yes.
But everything comes from within her.
Yes.
She never had any training, never went to school, but hardly went to school for education, let alone art. So everything is really from within. It's really pure, and it hasn't been touched, just like kids, but it's a grown woman. And that I found very astounding, very interesting, to watch her development. And then you have the kids that are doing this. They're starting from the same ground zero at a much younger age. So by the time they're 15, 18, 20, they have some sort of background in their art. But it's an interesting development. It's been an interesting road. And we used the art as a means, as a vehicle, to get them interested in to the education. We're an after-school program. We have accredited school teachers that help the kids with their homework. The normal day, first of all, school is not mandatory in Nicaragua. You go at 7 o'clock and you finish up at 12 in the afternoon if you go. If you don't go, you dally around the house or do some chores or whatever. The state doesn't come find you. It's not mandatory. So when the kids finally finish their day at 12 o'clock, they come to Una Escolita at 12:30, and we help tutor them with their academics. They'd come and we do art, and every kid that comes gets a free meal. The attraction initially was the free meal. Then the attraction was the free meal and the art.
And yeah, then it became the art.
And now it's the art
and the free meal.
The free meal and to
better
themselves in school.
Yes.
Because they've come to the understanding through the help of what we've been doing that
education is important.
Education is important.
Yeah.
And, you know, getting good grades and attending. When we first opened up, we saw the effect of what we were doing, and we saw our success instantaneously. The head of the school, the government-run school, came to visit Pope one day early on and said, "I want to commend you guys, Una Escolita, for what you're doing and what you've brought here. A, I can tell the students that are from Una Escolita who come to my school. A, they come. B, they bring their homework completed. And C, they're better behaved than the other children."
Mm-hmm.
That's instant gratification for
yes.
what we're doing.
Absolutely.
It's success. Then there's a big success story. Around December is when they take their break. They take about almost a two-month break in between classes, in between semesters. And before that break, they take a test. If you take the test and you pass, you go to the next grade. You take the test and you fail, you get left back. Well, it was little Gerald.
Yeah, our hero.
And little Gerald was in the second grade and he failed. And he was going to be left back. What a stigmatism to be in the second grade, start your life off as a failure, having to do that over again. You live with that your entire life.
It's true.
Little Gerald came to Una Escolita during that 6 or 8 week period of the break. And he was tutored, and the school allowed him to take the test over again. Little Gerald passed. Not only did little Gerald pass, but the next grade, he was one of the highest scorers in his class.
Mm-hmm.
Today, little Gerald is studious, he likes art, and he plays baseball on the baseball field. The principal came and told us that out of all the classes, each grade, the highest scorers are from Una Escolita. And for that, that's what we're here for. And it's all for us.
Yeah, no, I understand that. Of course, it's a universal issue. I mean, you know, compassion is a universal aspect of, you know, trying to do something good for others. You know, at first I thought, well, you know, we have enough troubles here. You know, people are hungry here. People need help here. Remember, we asked you
yes.
that question last before.
Yes.
So why do you have to go overseas to help others? But obviously, it's a universal aspect of compassion towards people
mm-hmm.
that has the same identical needs, you know,
mm-hmm.
if it's education, if it's food, if it's art, if it's whatever it is that really triggers warmth, triggers closeness that they don't get on the daily.
Absolutely.
And I think that serves the purpose no matter where you are.
I've come to learn so much through this project. I've come to learn so much about myself, you know. As I said earlier on, my worst enemy in my head is me. You know, constantly thinking about myself is not good for me. This allows me to get out of myself. I have people in this community that ask me, why go to Nicaragua? There are poor kids, starving kids here. Why? Because they're there.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that simple. How we got there, it's a long, long story, but we got there. And that's where we found ourselves, looking at ourselves, looking at each other one day, saying we were going to get into a land business, where we were going to flip land, buy land, subdivide it, and be land barons.
Yes.
Okay. Well, that didn't work out only because we looked at one another one day and we said, we're taking a lot from this community. And you know what? We're of the age where we want to feel good. I want to feel good on as often as possible.
Yes.
About myself, about him.
Yes.
He wants to feel good also.
Yes.
And we found the best way to feel good is to do something for someone else.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
That's how this all started to snowball. I've gotten very involved with the East Hampton Synagogue, the temple. And my girlfriend, Bobby Braun, she's introduced me to those folks at the temple. And growing up in Brooklyn in Bensonhurst, Jewish folks were Hasidic Jews with curls and black hats, white shirts that were really gray,
beards,
and you know they had a certain scent about them. You know, that was my impression of Jewish folks. I've come to understand that the people at this temple, now this is not a plug for Judaism or Templism or anything, but these folks have the same philosophy as Pope and I. And it's just do good. Do good for people. Do good for one another. That's why we're here. The more we do for other people, the better off the world is going to be.
And it stretches a long way, you know, especially in times that, you know, as the times that we're going through right now.
They're a big supporter of Una Escalita, that the congregation, the rabbi, Shelley. I've gotten to know him quite well. And he's quite a humanitarian. He's supported us monetarily, verbally, and within his congregation. I'm really indebted to him.
Yeah, I'm very glad to hear that.
Yeah. And being involved with that temple has really changed my views on my prejudiced thinking towards Jewish folks. And I feel better about it. I'm more open.
I took you to a seder, Pesach seder. Don't forget that, so forgive me. So. But anyway, we hear, first of all, obviously there's going to be a wonderful event, which we want to mention more than once, which we're going to get all the particulars from Frank. So tell us first of all, before we run out of time, about the event that's going to take place to support Una Escalita.
Yeah, we're going to next Saturday, September 24th, at the Beach House in East Hampton, the restaurant, the Beach House. We're going to have a great dance party. Something that very few people have an opportunity to do. I know as earlier on, there used to be a lot of places to go dancing, but that seems to have petered out, and our age bracket hardly ever goes dancing. So this event is going to be at the Beach House. It's going to be $50 in admission donation. It's free hors d'oeuvres, a silent auction. There'll be a 50-50 raffle and a cash bar. Michael, who's the owner of the Beach House, has been so generous beyond our wildest dreams. We would like to generate $35,000. That would keep the school going for another year. And it'll help us with our volunteer program, which we've really established. We have volunteers coming from all over the world, a lot of volunteers from Germany. What's the name? YAP? Is that the name?
Youth Action for Peace. It's a worldwide, they send something like 200 volunteers to various projects around the world. They get over 2,000 applicants. They go to Berlin and they go to seminars and get interviewed and everything, and everybody gets put in the place of their interest and where they're going to do best. And I get the most amazing young German girls, mostly girls, some men, who are usually in between high school and college, or 1 or 2 years of college, and they're going into some kind of either going to be teachers or social work, and they come and spend 6 months to a year with us. And I got to say, they're great.
Yes, I know. The last time we were here, we had the footage of your volunteers and that wonderful German girl that was in association with her work with kids and all that.
Yes.
So I actually meant to talk about the volunteering aspect of
they all
people
come
that
back.
I work for.
They go back to Germany and they come back and visit with their boyfriends or their husbands, and they stay at the school for a week or two on what is a vacation for them. And they're all on our Facebook thing, and some of the girls and children who've been with us for 4 years are like 13 years old, and they're learning how to use computers, and I get email from them. It's I can hardly work Facebook.
Yes.
We just had a volunteer, a young girl by the name of April, who's from this community, East Hampton. She's a student at the Ross School. She's going into her senior year. She just came back from a two-week volunteer stay with Pope at the school, and it was quite an eye-opening experience for her. She'll be at the benefit.
So other than willingness to volunteer, what kind of capabilities do those young girls or boys that come and volunteer need to have?
What we've just instilled is a do good surfer volunteer program, where if you wanted to come to Nicaragua, to Una Escalita, to go surfing, say for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month, the summer, 6 months, you could incorporate your surfing, volunteering at Una Escalita to do good, develop a program with one of our teachers, and continue that program with the children, be part of the community, get involved with Una Escalita. All volunteers pay a fee to come and volunteer, which is the standard in the industry of volunteering. They leave a donation, and they leave their footprint as to what they've done with these children. They can then come back online to monitor where they've been, what they've done. They could make another appearance in a year or so. They can come with a friend or two and volunteer. We have accommodations where we can accommodate how many volunteers at one given time?
Four easily.
Yeah, and if we get loaded filled up, there are other accommodations right within walking distance. One of the thrusts that we must do, one of the things that we must do to sustain our what we're doing here with the school, is to make the school self-sustained. It has to stand on its own 2 feet. We cannot continually do benefits to try to keep the school afloat. The benefits should be a side juncture as to a supplement to the school supplying itself, and the only way the school is going to supply itself is by a volunteer program. What we must and what we want to do dearly is to build a dormitory that'll house 20, 25 volunteers on a continual basis. What that does, it allows the people in the community to have a few jobs that have never, we can create some jobs.
Yes.
The ultimate goal here is that the Nicaraguans, the community, winds up with what we've started doing. We don't want to be here in another 10 years running this school. We want to be able to turn it over to reputable, substantial people. We have a Nicaraguan board of directors. We're a 501c corporation. We're a non-for-profit in the States and also in Nicaragua. And we don't want to be the lords of the manor. We want to be able to just guide the people and show them the way to run this place, and then let them develop from what we have
established. Yes, right.
And being self-sustained, standing on their own 2 feet, not getting public assistance or any assistance from the government, keeps them independent. They need their independence. They have to learn how to run the organization. Once we can freely hand it over to them, the better off we are. We've done our job.
And that's so you're working on establishing this human infrastructure.
Absolutely. And Pope is working on that. He's there every day.
Yeah.
He's the day-to-day guy.
Yeah.
He's on the battlefield.
Yes.
And it's a battle.
Yeah.
Because the illiteracy is unbelievable. You have people our age walking around with a fourth grade
X's.
A fourth grade
X's. X's. A signature.
So, you know, they believe in voodoo, they believe in the boogeyman, they believe in whatever is, whoever can influence the most in their beliefs.
Yes,
and
yes.
It's hard to reason with people like this, and in lots of situations. It's a strain on Pope. It's a day-to-day battle.
I'm sure it is. But again, I wanted to mention that it's going to take place on September 24th. From 7 to 11, and the Beach House, if you don't know where it is about half a mile west from the bowling alley.
Near the bowling alley, across the road from Nichols Restaurant.
Yes.
There's the address on there.
Yes.
At the bottom.
Yes, it's 103 Montauk Highway in East Hampton.
Right.
And that's, again, Saturday night from 7 to 11. And, of course, I'm going to hammer the issue between now and then.
Bluestone is the band. We'll have a five-piece band, two vocalists, and lots of great dancing music.
And also, you know, I still have the footage from last meeting that we have here, so maybe during the week I will run a portion of
that
interview, and this will give them a little more of an idea of what the school is all about, because we actually, in detail, spoke about that. So then again, what I commend is the whole idea of compassion. So much needed. Man, I mean, everyone is suffering now anyway, in one way or shape or form. People are experiencing things that they never thought they would have to go through. So to hear, I think, Mulet's Kulita becomes a little more significant as one struggles, even in a community like ours, that we think everything is in abundance and all that.
I'd be very surprised in this well-established, polished community that we live in, how the pantry, and the synagogue has a drive for clothing, for winter coats, and they can't get enough. They bring in, when it starts to get cold, these are people that have jobs, that can't afford the rent, that have lost the house, can't pay the mortgage, can't feed their kids, and it's East Hampton.
Yes,
it is our town.
Yes, I know.
You would never believe it.
Yes, I know. And so that's why any display of compassion, any display of wanting to help the others, you know, is something that actually, you know, I always tell my friends, it's all about the energy, the release of energy. Even if you don't intend to release the energy, you're involved in that. It's inevitable. It's just dispersed out of you, outwards, and you know, that's something good.
It's really easy down there to get caught up in all the details and the wildness and everything, the craziness that goes on in these third world countries. But exactly what you said, the energy, I look at it, we just keep trying to do love and service and be kind but firm and not get caught up in the drama that goes on in these places. And it's an energetic thing.
Yes.
Just keep
yes.
doing good, keep doing good, keep doing good.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, again, it is a $50 fee, but tell us again what they're getting for it, and you know, those who are thinking about dinner and about food, after all, anyway, they're...
Well, these are hors d'oeuvres. It's not a dinner. You can, if you'd like to stay and have a dinner at the Beach House, they'd be more than welcome to accommodate you. But there's a cash bar, but there are, and there will be free hors d'oeuvres, great food, great music, a silent auction, a 50-50 raffle. Hopefully, the more people come, the bigger the raffle will be. And if anyone has some real compassion and they won that 50-50 raffle,
they can donate it all together. There you go.
That's what's happened in the last few years.
But they can donate more than $50 if someone wants.
Oh,
correct?
You know what? We'll be more than happy to take more.
Yes. You never know.
There are an awful lot of generous people in this community. We have a lot of friends that, I mean, I can't even begin to name them, that have been so compassionate. We've had donations as high as $5,000 from individuals, quite a few $500 donations, many, many $100 donations, many, many people, just the $50, and some people saying, I'm short, if I had some money, I would definitely give it to you, but maybe next time. And you know what? That's okay too. You know, Just knowing what we're doing and being able to spread the word for us is as good as the money. So it comes in many different ways. Obviously, we need the money to sustain ourselves, to keep going.
Of course.
And the goal is to not have to have these benefits to sustain ourselves. The benefits, hopefully, in the future will be an additive to the school living, being able to do its own thing.
Absolutely.
And that's the goal.
Absolutely.
And maybe by the time we're ready to turn it all over, we'll reach that goal.
Absolutely. And you know, people out there, you know me, they know me, I speak. I have the issues all the time. It's all about art. It's all about, you know. And I remember when I started Project Most, I told the one who runs it, you know, when they graduate school, when they after high school, when they go to college, who are they going to remember? They're going to remember me. See, and that's, in my eyes, it's a given. You know, even though they can see me 1 hour a month or something like that, but they're going to remember me. They're going to remember the interactions with the drums and with the poetry and with the painting, even though it was brief. I know the influence and how deep it runs when it comes to interacting with art and influencing the young generation with that engagement.
It's interesting you say that, because our goal is not to build doctors, lawyers, or engineers. We're just looking to build good, solid citizens, people that will have respect for themselves, ultimately. If you respect yourself, you can respect the things around you. And if we can just develop that and instill that in these young folks, you know, the young girls especially, they aspire to have children, babies, as soon as they are able to, 12, 13. They aspire to have a kid, a baby, at that young age. Why? Because that's what they've been taught.
That's what they're taught.
That's what their mother's done, their sister. There are grandmothers that are 32 years old, and they're a grandmother. You know, that's pretty
crazy.
Do the myth.
Yes.
You know, so we're not there to be... you know, to be a birth control demons and tell them that they this is how they should do their lives. No, we want them to just have a better, clearer understanding of the world and what's available to them. Then they can make decisions on their own.
Yeah.
And see that there's a big world out there. And then, you know, enter the world with a better understanding rather than be so narrow-minded.
Yes.
And pigeonholed and be our age with a fourth grade education. That's not cool.
Not cool at all.
4.2 nationwide is the average, and that would include the cities. Where we are, I would call it two years average.
Hmm. And the government likes it that way. Because
they have the control, of course.
Right.
Yeah,
we're not political.
Yes.
But the last thing we want to be even thinking about is being, we want to stay away from religion, politics, and any other controversy.
They will take you away from the message. You know,
when we first went down there, we wanted to build some tables so that when we served our meal, the kids could eat at a table. Hardly any of these kids ate at a table because they lived in a one-room shack and they sat on a few little rocks or a cot. Their kitchen is in the corner with some bricks, the wood-burning stove.
You get a plate.
Right.
There's a hierarchy for the chairs.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yes.
So a big social event was to sit at a table and have a meal. And
we had some 12-foot tables.
Yes.
They're kind of eerily looking.
Yes.
A simple social event, like sitting at a table, having a meal, and discussing the day's event had never been done.
Yes.
And here we're talking about kids 10, 12, 15 years old. Adults.
Amazing.
Yeah. So it's just a simplicity of what we take for granted. To break through that cycle and to have them develop mentally, physically, and emotionally to a better, higher archy is just the goal.
Great. We got 2 minutes to go. We're sitting here with Franco Canova and Pope Noel on Monday morning, September 19th, 2011, here with the Halo Show. My name is Chaim Mizrahi. Again, September 24th from 7 to 11 at the Beach House. A wonderful gathering with the music, with the Julie Bluestone, hors d'oeuvres.
A benefit for Una Escalita.
Una Escalita, of course. And it's a suggested donation of $50. And of course, I'm going to hammer the issue and show some footage these coming days leading to the event. And again, we'll ask for later. Will be the benefit. And anything you want to add, Frank, to conclude our session this morning?
Well, you know, I've been saying this now since this benefit was in its beginning. The success of this benefit will be through the folks in the community. And the more we get the word out, and the louder we say this, the more people will come, and that's where the proof of the pudding will be.
Perfect. Thank you so much for showing up this